I've been very busy for these last few weeks. I've been having school. I've been having plenty to do. For my last week, actually, I've been preoccupying myself with a little side project of mine. I was having me, my friend Vova, and Arden, we were in my garage and we were fixing up my boat. Now, it had a deck that was rotten for a really long time, so we finally took the initiative and we said, okay, let's get this done. We spent a bunch of hours in it and we fixed it, right? So, to reward ourselves, today is the opening of fishing season for the year, given the coronavirus, of course. So we took the boat out, we went out down to Spring Lake, and we went fishing. We went fishing over there, and then we were on the boat, just chilling. We actually made some shishlikki on the boat. I bring my own portable propane tank, and we just start cooking. We start cooking, we caught some shishlikki, we ate them up, and we caught a bunch of fish. We got actually 20 trout. 20 big old trout, right? Now, we were very, very, very lucky. We got, I think, 5-6 jumbo trout. And it was wonderful. It was wonderful catching something that you always try to catch and you actually end up doing it. Now, the reason why I bring up fishing is because Bible actually talks about fishing. It talks about fishing, and all the sorts. I know many of you know about Jonah and the big fish. Many of you know about how Jesus helped the disciples fish. Now, before we start with that, I want to actually take a little step back. So, John 21 is a chapter where we have the story about Jesus helping the disciples with their fish. John 20 is where we're starting today. It's very important that we start at John 20 to get proper context for John 21. That's a very important thing we have to do as Christians. We have to read before and after the verses in order to get the proper context. So, in John 20, this is the chapter in which Jesus resurrects himself. Resurrects himself and he starts showing himself to many, many people. Include his disciples, Mary Magdalene, and one little fella named Thomas. Now, Thomas, he is a lot like many of us. Many, many, many of us. So, don't take my word for it. Let's start reading the Bible and read a little bit how Jesus talked to Thomas. All right. We'll start at John 20. We'll go from verses 19 to 29. 19. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them. Remember, this is after he resurrected himself. And said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples, actually mentioning, a week later, it wasn't the day after Jesus resurrected, a week later after he showed himself to disciples, a week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Through the doors, though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." As you can see, Thomas was a doubter. Thomas needed actual proof in order to fully believe that Jesus had fully resurrected himself. He needed that extra push. He didn't just believe what the disciples said. He's like many of us. That's the truth about it. Many of us have a really hard time believing about Jesus. But what did Jesus do? Did Jesus just say, "Ye have little faith," and let Thomas not believe? Did he just let Thomas doubt uncontrollably? No. Jesus actually talked to Thomas and said, "You said you want to see the holes in my hands? They're right here. You want to see the hole in my side? It's right here." And Thomas believed. Thomas had the evidence that he wanted in order to believe in Jesus Christ. Now, many of us still have some doubts in the back of our head. Whether we like it or not, that's how it is. No matter how hard we try, we always have some doubts in our head. There's some little voice always telling us, "What if that wasn't true? What if that wasn't true? What if?" That's what my first point is today. I want us to find the proof. Find the proof for Jesus Christ. Don't believe just anything anybody says. Now, where is the proof? We could find the proof through his word, the Bible. The Bible is an account of many, many witnesses of Jesus Christ. Many prophecies and truths that are fulfilled continuously. If it was maybe just one prophecy out of nowhere, okay, I understand. That's cool. But there's hundreds of prophecies that are fulfilled from the Old Testament to the New. What I urge all of you to do is take the initiative to actually look at these prophecies that the Old Testament gives us, and then once we have those prophecies, look into the New Testament, see how they are fulfilled by Jesus Christ. How we can see the proof that Jesus Christ is the Messiah, the one sent for our sins. Jesus is giving you his hand and giving you his side just to touch it through his word. The real question is whether we actually decide to pick it up and listen to it. I know many of us have a hard time doing it, but we need to take that initiative. We need to, so we can have a firm foundation of what we believe. If we don't have a firm foundation, really, then what does it all mean? Nothing. Because empty faith is empty faith. But faith that has backed up by the truths that the Bible gives us is a strong, strong and sturdy faith that cannot be blown down by any wind. It cannot be blown down by any doubt. I can tell you that Thomas did not have any more doubt after he saw that. And I can tell you that if you take the initiative and read the Bible for what it is, you won't have any doubt as well. Now, if you really want to start, here's for the beginners. Isaiah 53 is a really, really good one. I'm not going to go into it, but if you're a beginner and you really want to look into prophecies and see how they're fulfilled through the New Testament, Isaiah 53 is a wonderful one to start out with. So, now that we have a firm foundation, or at least the knowledge to have a firm foundation, what exactly do we do with that? This is where the fishing part comes in. Because John 21, the very beginning of John 21, is actually a story about how two disciples went fishing and how Jesus did something with a fishing trip. Let's read it. John 21, verse 1. Afterwards, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them. And they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out and got into the boat. But that night, they had caught nothing. They didn't even catch one single thing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple, whom Jesus loved, said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals. There were fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of fish, 153. Side note, the maximum fish I ever caught was 100 with a group of friends. 153 is unbelievable. That is a lot. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" This is the most important part. They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. So what I really want us to get here is that Jesus gave the disciples direction. Right? Jesus said, "Fish on the right side of the boat." The disciples had faith, and they followed his directions. They didn't just have faith. They didn't just believe, "Oh, I believe you, Jesus. The right side of the boat has fish, but they continue to be on the left side." No. They believed what Jesus said, and they followed his directions. They moved the nets over to the right side, and they had a bountiful catch. What did they have at the beginning? When they were on their own, they had zero fish. When they had Jesus' direction, they had 153 fish. By following that simple direction that Jesus gave them, it went from a disappointing catch to a bountiful one that they couldn't even bring the net in. That's the power of Jesus. The power of Jesus is so strong that simply following his direction leads to things in this world that we couldn't comprehend. We couldn't even believe. But what's the most important thing? That we believe and follow what Jesus has to tell us. We believe and we do what Jesus has to tell us. We are not just to believe and that's it. There is no bountiful catch from that. Imagine if we actually did what Jesus told us. We could do a lot. But I'm actually saying something that is contradictory to itself. How do we know what Jesus directed us to do if no one has told you? If no one has told you, where do you go for it? That's right, the same answer to the first point, the Bible. When looking at what Jesus tells us to do, we can't just believe anybody. If you believe anybody, they could tell you to do something wrong. But instead, we should go right into the Bible. So, what I want us to do is to go into the Bible and see what Jesus has to tell us. Let's go to Mark chapter 1, 16 through 20. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little further, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat. Preparing their nets without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. That's what we're supposed to do. We're not just supposed to be living on our own, right? We're supposed to be following Jesus. We're supposed to be going for what Jesus wants us to do. We're supposed to take the tools that he gave us to help as many people as possible, to spread the gospel. Now, we could get some tools like a fishing box. We could get some tools like a net. We could even get some tools like a fishing rod, right? But we're not actually fishing. We're looking for people. So what tool we gotta use? The Bible. Now, what if you don't have your Bible on you? You need to have the knowledge from the Bible in your head. You have to have the initiative to follow what Jesus has to say. This is what I want to encourage for all of you to do. To read the Bible genuinely, thoroughly, to understand it within the context that it gives itself. To have the courage to preach to others exactly what the Bible tells you to do, so that you may find other people doing the same thing as yourself. We are continuing and need to continue to teach other people about what God has done for them, how God has sent his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, to die for our sins. If we don't do that, who will tell them? Nobody. We have to take it. We have to step forward, and we have to continue the work that God has given us in our lives. When Jesus ascended, Jesus gave us the mission to go forth and make disciples. Is that something you can say that you're helping contribute to? As a Christian, can you really do that? I know none of us are perfect. All I'm asking is that we genuinely try. That we genuinely try to see what the Bible wants us to do. That we don't just idly stand by. That we don't just continue to do nothing. That we find the places to help. That's what I want us to do. So to recap, what I'd like us to do is to find a firm foundation in ourselves. In the faith that we have in the Bible, in the faith that we have in Jesus Christ as our Messiah, in the faith that we have in God, a strong and deep foundation that we have. If we don't have that, we have nothing. Once you have that foundation, you have to find out what to do next. You have to believe what Jesus says, and you have to follow his directions. Once you do that, you continue to do it, and you never stop. You don't ever relent, because that's all you're here to do. You're here to save as many people as possible. You're here to be the instrument that Jesus gives us. You're here to throw the seeds and let God do the rest. That's what we all need to do. And if we don't do it, who will? So today I urge all of you to be like fishermen, but fishermen for men. Find the right tools. Find the right bait. Find the right path in order to save as many people as possible. Because we're here to catch as many souls up as long as with us. We're here to bring as many souls as possible up to heaven with us. We don't want it to be a lonely place. We want to teach. We want to love one another. And if we don't do that, nobody will. So to end with this, go fishing, everybody. Go fishing for people. And if you want, go fishing for fish too. Right now, it's a wonderful time to go fishing. Fishing season just started. It's beautiful. But most of all, when you're there, when you're outside and you meet some people, I know you're still going to still be wearing your masks, right? But you can still talk to people. And when you're talking to that fisherman right next to you, tell him about Jesus. Tell him about how Jesus saved you. Tell him how Jesus saved a wretched sinner like you and I, and that he could save that person as well. How he can save every single person as long as you have faith. That is what I want to leave you with today. So, in conclusion, I want us to pray. If you have any sort of prayer request that you would like to have, please write it down and we could pray about it. Now, it isn't just me. I said we for a reason. We, as a congregation, we as every person here, will pray along with you. It's called the prayer of communion. We decide on topic together. And if nobody has any prayers, that's perfect. We could just pray together for thanks. We could pray together for the thanks that we have in our lives. For the health we have, for the housing we have, for all the miracles we have on the daily basis, for the health that people in our family have, for the people that believe in our families.